It's great to see you in studio.
Well, glad to be here. Thank you.
It's it's now 1 week. We're almost there. The sleepless, tireless sprint to the finish has begun. And it's getting a little ugly out there, and there is an ad that does not come from the state party, but does come from Andrew Cuomo, and I'd like you to take a look at it, although I'm sure you've already seen it.
Who can clean up Albany? Not the Palladino team. His campaign manager has a federal tax lien for not paying $53,000 in taxes. His senior advisor is under indictment for stealing over $1 million. Another top advisor was sentenced to jail for a hit-and-run DUI and has an open arrest warrant. The Republican chairman, Richard Nixon's son-in-law, a master of dirty tricks, leading one of the nastiest campaigns in the country. You can't clean up Albany with dirty hands.
Okay, so that's your counterpart, Ed Cox, and he is apparently a master of dirty tricks and running the nastiest campaign in America, and he says that's ludicrous.
Well, the Palladino campaign, frankly, has said some really awful things about Andrew Cuomo and his record, distorted it from the beginning. This has been a very contentious campaign. That's been the Palladino way. And his entire team has to have the responsibility to look at themselves and say, are they running the type of campaign that New Yorkers want? So my point to you today is this. This is a response ad. You're going to see these in politics. The Cuomo campaign is not going to sit idly by, be attacked again and again with false statements about people that the Palladino campaign wants to attack and just let it go by.
But doesn't that just really bring us to a race to the bottom, which is exactly what Andrew Cuomo said he didn't want to do? He said he was not going to get down in the gutter. He was not going to sling mud. And that we just looked at there is pretty dirty.
Well, you know, again, it becomes very difficult and you have a hard choice. Because when you don't respond, you then find yourself in the position of, being... without anything in your gun. I mean, you have to be able to respond, and that's what he did. That's what the campaign did, and they felt it was important. The ad that you didn't show was the Palladino ad that attacks Andrew Cuomo very vehemently and falsely. I mean, it's full of false statements.
Well, the ad that you're speaking of is an ad that went up that has to do with Steve Rattner, right? Obama's car czar, and Pedro Espada. And I can't remember who the third one is.
I mean, but even Pedro Espada.
That's right, Andrew Farkas.
But even with Pedro Espada, who went after Pedro Espada more than Andrew Cuomo has?
Well, I think the issue was civil. He went after him in a civil way. He brought multiple civil suits against him, but he didn't bring criminal charges against him. And this is a nuance because he doesn't have the power to do so from the AG's office.
Exactly. Right. So, it's unfair. I mean, you can only do what you can do, and he did everything he could do. Andrew Cuomo has fought corruption in government vigorously from the get-go.
But
that is his entire record.
Don't we get into a place where it's like, you started it, which is exactly the kind of finger-pointing that voters say that they just don't like. They don't want to hear it anymore.
Well, look, that's the nature of campaigning today and in today's times. And perhaps it's unfortunate that we all go down those roads. But negative campaigning at times, if you don't answer them, it's shown you lose points in the polls. And no one wants to do that. No one can afford to do that. You have to respond. You have to respond vigorously. I would say that when you look at the people who work directly for Carl Palladino, he's got far more to answer for by any means than the charges that he's making. So I'm just saying to you, look, what we should be focusing on are the issues. Andrew Cuomo has presented the most detailed policy proposals for the future of New York State and the vision that he wants for New York State. Andrew Cuomo is going to fix our problems. Carl Palladino has spent a campaign bashing Andrew Cuomo and everybody else, even people in his own party, if it suits his purposes. And frankly, I don't want to get into who started this. We know who started it, but the campaign should finish up, and Andrew is finishing it up on a positive with issues.
Well, that was not positive, though, however, let's just say.
Well, I'm not saying that's the finish either.
Okay, all right. Well, then we'll be finishing positively. Let's talk for a second, then, if you want to talk about policy and issues, about a story that was appearing in this morning's New York Times. You have Andrew Cuomo giving an extended interview to the New York Times and talking about how giving some light about how he might govern, although of course he's not yet elected, and taking on the public employee unions quite harshly. Now, why does this make sense? You're in the final stretch of a campaign. The unions are giving you boots on the ground. The unions are giving you get out the vote. The unions are your base. and you hit them hard with X number of days to go to the election.
Well, Liz, you know, it's interesting. If he didn't say anything, everybody'd say he's not telling us what he would do.
I don't know that you have to sit down with the New York Times and give them a play-by-play about what you're going to do when you come here to have a budget battle.
The bottom line of it is, and I read that article, and I have to tell you, it takes a certain measure of courage. You know what Andrew Cuomo did today? He was honest. And he said straight up to people, you know, the problem we have in politics, let's remember, is that election time candidates say one thing to get elected, and then after they do something different. That's not Andrew Cuomo. He's honest. He's straightforward. And I read this article today. There is nothing in that article that he has not been saying quite clearly since he began this run. It's been very straightforward. Look, the unions are our friends.
I think it's the timing that people were caught off guard by.
But Andrew Cuomo is an honest player. And the timing is such that this is when voters are taking a look and they're saying, who can we trust to fix our problems? Andrew Cuomo stood up there and said, look, these are my friends, but I got to tell it straight. We have to do business differently, and we're going to at times disagree.
Fair enough. Here's the problem, though. Have you read, for example, other articles that have come out, I would say, over the past 2 weeks about his lack of transparency when it comes to where he's going to be in terms of his scheduling? For example, there was a story in the Buffalo News, there was a story in the Omni Times Union. It's very difficult to get information out of a guy who says that transparency is his number one priority.
Well, his schedule, I mean, that's an issue for you know, a campaign in terms of where you're going. But what's been very transparent is what the voters want to know. What are you going to do when you are a governor? He just put out a comprehensive urban agenda. He has had multiple books presented on a variety
six.
Of issues.
Yes, six of them.
And six of them, and let me tell you, those are not light reading, and they're thorough. But what candidate have you seen that has done that in the past? Typically, the press complains that candidates talk in platitudes and generalities. Here you have somebody running for governor who has had the courage, the foresight, and the vision to lay out in quite a good amount of detail what specifically he wants to do. That's what voters want. Andrew Cuomo is a different kind of candidate, as we've seen, and he'll be a different kind of governor.
Well, do you expect that next year, assuming that he is elected governor, will be ugly?
I don't think it's going to be ugly, because I think that what Andrew Cuomo also has is the capacity to bring people to the table, to listen, to understand, to try to build consensus. He has a leadership style that I think is rather unique. I've been very impressed with it from what I've been able to see, as have others. And I think that while it won't be easy, and nothing's easy when you're asking people to sacrifice a bit and contribute, what he's going to be doing is putting together a fair program to try to get our state back into balance and fix what our problems have been.
What about AEG and the state Senate? I mean, at this point, how much of an impact do you think that Racino scandal from the state inspector general's report that we saw, a bombshell, really bad for the Senate Democrats? You got to admit that much. I mean, it does not look good for them.
Well, I know, again, these were reports that had been in the press for a while, and now the report came out officially. And I will tell you, it is serious. And it merits a very strong look. And look, it's been referred to both the federal prosecutor and New York County prosecutor, I believe.
Yep.
And so that will be looked at. And you know something about Democrats, and I'll say this. Voters need to remember, Democrats have proven their ability when and if it's necessary to clean our own house. And we have done that in the past.
Do you
when
think and that's if it's necessary in this case?
I said when John, and if.
Can John Sampson continue to lead? You already have candidates, two that I can think of, and that's Joanne Yepsen in the Capital Region and Mike Kaplowitz, who is running very strong, actually, for the Senate in the Hudson Valley, have said that they will not vote for John Sampson for leader. They will not vote for him if they are elected. Now, and he's under investigation. Now, we don't know what the Manhattan DA is going to do. We don't know what the U.S. Attorney is going to do. Can John Sampson continue to lead?
I think that you have to wait to see what those prosecutors are going to do. And I think that that's an important piece. I don't want to convict anybody ahead, but I will say to you that what I don't think we should do is allow the voters to get distracted on this issue, important though it is, in place of all of the very much more important to the voter issues like property taxes and jobs.
Wait,
that Democrats
have to. Public corruption is not important to voters?
I didn't say that. I said they shouldn't be distracted by this issue, which is going to be before a and it's alleged public.
Yes, it
okay,
is.
Okay,
that's
alleged.
True.
That's going to the prosecutors, and they're going to take a look at it. And before an election, when it's 8-10 days out from an election, that shouldn't be the defining piece of an election. We've got jobs here in New York State that we need to find. We've got major issues with our budget. We've got property taxes that are out of control for many citizens. This is what the Democrats are fighting for. This is what Andrew Cuomo is fighting for. And the best thing voters can do is elect Andrew Cuomo, who has a record of fighting for good ethics and for change and reform, and he's going to do that in Albany, and that's really what we're talking about right now.
How worried are you about the congressional seats right now?
I always worry. That's my job.
Okay,
I'm supposed
Jay,
to worry.
You look pretty relaxed to me, I just have to say. Seriously, though, because there are reports today. First of all, the Republicans tell me there are as many as 11 seats in play. That's very high. I mean, we had Chairman Cox was here saying that's an unusual number in a Democrat-dominated state. And very worried about people, for example, in the suburbs. You have, for example, Carolyn McCarthy on Long mm-hmm. Island, worried about her. Worried about John Hall in the Hudson Valley. Democratic congressmen are saying they're concerned about their colleagues in these locations that were once considered fairly safe.
Well, it's a very tough year for Democrats and incumbents throughout the country. So New York is not immune to that. And while, you know, we should be concerned, because you never know who's going to come out. If Democrats come out, if Democrats stand with the Democratic agenda and what the majority has done in Washington, and Democrats come out and vote, we're going to do just fine. If they stay home, we're going to have a problem. So that's why people are worried. I would have to tell you that I think it would be a tremendous mistake to turn around and go backwards. And that's exactly what we would be doing if we elect a Republican majority in the House this year.
Do you believe that will happen? Because it seems that all signs are pointing in that direction.
Well, I think that, you know, in these off-year elections, the midterm elections, particularly of a new president, you do lose seats. We have 39 seats in total to spare, and my guess is that number is going to be whittled down to some degree. We've got bigger troubles in other states. In New York State, I don't see us having anything like 11 seats to worry about. I see more concern on three or four seats that, you know, we're watching and we're working on to make sure we get those votes out.
Well, I know you're going to be working very hard. We'll be seeing you, I'm sure, on election night. In the meantime, I want to thank you very much for coming in. Jay Jacobs, thanks so much.
Again, thanks for having me.